that we're going to present on some current mergers and acquisitions that have been in the news lately, and talk about history of mergers, and then some of the big ones that are going on right now, or have been shut down in the last week, or and also the Trump administration's stance on mergers and acquisitions. So the first wave is primarily characterized by large horizontal mergers that birthed basically these large giants. So this is where oil tycoons came about, large steel companies, railroad companies, and other giants in these very industrial sectors. So companies realized that it was good to be diverse, and that if you are a diverse company, you might weather through the Great Depression easier than a monopolist. The fourth wave is largely hostile mergers. So this is when a company goes and buys up another company's stock and basically takes over. And they were capitalizing on inefficiencies that were created by these large conglomerates. You can think of this with regards to GE selling off some of their other businesses. They chose to do that. And lastly, the fifth wave is kind of what we're seeing today, which is large mega deals that are happening between international firms. So the Sherman Antitrust Act, you've probably heard of it. It gives a basis for making sure that these large companies aren't monopolists. And then the Clayton Act bill falls with that. So one of the things that the Clayton Act did was give actual standards for making sure that mergers didn't go through. And one of these standards was the HHI, or the Herfindahl-Hirschman Index, which is a way of testing market concentration. And then lastly, the Glass-Steagall Act, you've probably heard of it, not really in practice anymore, but that was about investment and consumer bank separation.
So CVS proposed to merge with Aetna this week. So CVS is a U.S. pharmacy operator, and Aetna is the number three health insurer in the United States, and they proposed to buy Aetna for $200 a share, or about $25 more than the current stock price of Aetna. So this would put a merger at a cost of about $66 billion and would result in a huge reordering of the healthcare market, as it is a pharmacy operator with an insurer. So some of the motives behind this for CVS would be just focusing on healthcare in general, as their retail sales are shrinking. So they're seeing weaker sales from their groceries and everything else in their physical stores. This will also result in improved negotiations with drug makers, and they would be allowed to set customer out-of-pocket costs for each drug and offer more benefits to clients. This would also fortify itself against competition. As you can see here, this is just a graph of the other companies that they are competing with. So you see United Health, Walgreens, and Express Scripts are just a few of the companies that they could be competing against, that they are competing against right now. So the future of the merger is potentially challenging. So this will be under close scrutiny from U.S. antitrust enforcers. Recently, Walgreens attempted to merge with Rite Aid, and the deal was cut back and back and back until they were only allowed to buy about one-third of the stores that they originally proposed. So there is a concern about healthcare consolidation in general, but they do want to see more. There is a potential for more competition with Amazon. So if a merger were to take place, it would take either months or years of negotiations before anything concrete would take place.
So the second deal we wanted to talk to you guys about is with AT&T and Time Warner. If you've read the news lately, it's one of the more prominent ones. And so just a little background about what this deal entails. It's obviously between AT&T and Time Warner. But what's interesting is that this is not recently announced. It was actually announced over a year ago at this time. For about $85.4 billion, AT&T was looking to acquire Time Warner. Now the deal is currently valued around $109 billion, so this would put it in that top, that top five space of the highest market share for a merger or an acquisition. So the question obviously is why Time Warner? Why does AT&T want to get into this process? So in the top there, you can think there's basically four parts in the whole process of communications and entertainment. Right now, AT&T themselves can handle the distribution and the marketing part. However, they want to have full control of their creative process and the production of content, which Time Warner would give them. with Americans shifting towards mobile screen entertainment consumption, this would be a huge plus for AT&T. They see that being very valuable. And the big hit is that HBO Now, which I'm sure all of you guys have heard of, if AT&T were to acquire Time Warner, they would be able to get paid twice. First, just through the cellular data plan that they provide, and second, through the subscription revenue from HBO. The Department of Justice actually just announced on November 8th that they were going to block this acquisition. So again, $109 million. It was blocked by Machen Dhillon, I think is his name. He's the new Assistant Attorney General of the Antitrust Division under the Trump administration. But they didn't essentially stop the deal from ever going through. They gave AT&T two options. They said you can either sell off one of the assets or sell off the other assets, and particularly DirecTV or the Turner Broadcasting Division.
So this is just a further trend of proposed merger. That is a further trend in wireless provider consolidation, which has been occurring amongst telecom companies since the federal government broke up the old AT&T company back in 1982. This breakup resulted in the creation of seven baby bell companies, in which Verizon and AT&T are the two remaining baby bells that still exist to this day and are the two major players in the wireless market. And then just recently, the FCC declared that there's effective competition for the first time in 8 years in the wireless market. So they're happy where it is. They think that all these companies are well proportioned in terms of market share, that consumers are they're not suffering at all.
Going into this, initially, when Trump was campaigning, he was on this platform that mergers should not happen, so he was completely against this. He said that these deals would lead to the accumulation of too much power in the hands of one company. And even though he said this, he contradicted himself by supporting the GM Fiat merger. This helping or hurting companies? The uncertainty surrounding the Trump administration could cause these companies that are planning to merge a lot of trouble. And the one person, Kurt Simon, global chairman of M&A at JP Morgan, he actually noted on a panel that tax reform is a near-term negative for deal-making. And what near-term negative means is that it's a drop in deal-making due to uncertainties in tax reform. The one good thing is that because of Trump's stance, change in stance, it will be smoother for companies to strike deals until the next president arrives.
Right, so every time a president changed, the graph dropped drastically. So in 2009, and then again in 2016. So now we go on to the discussion.